Hi, my name is Josh Pate, and I'm a faculty member at James Madison University in the Hart School and focusing in sport and recreation management. And I'm going to talk today about disability sport and inclusion and hopefully take us beyond the feel-good stories when it comes to disability in our sport sections. This time I'm going to share my screen so that you'll be able to follow along with a PowerPoint slideshow that I've created. We're sharing the screen now, and I'll move it into presentation mode to give you a little clearer view, hopefully. But there's my contact information, and anytime you need to reach out, I'll be glad to have these conversations with you. I want to start with some friends at Saturday Night Live. At one point a couple of years ago, they focused on a skit that was called The Champ, and it was about a wrestler who had beaten an undefeated wrestler, a competitor who was undefeated for several matches, several years actually. And the whole skit sort of begins by highlighting the successes of this wrestler named Nate, because he upset Tyler Stevens, a local wrestler who was just so successful, and it was so unexpected. But what we realize as the skit plays out is that Nate sits down with his family to watch the news, and this story is highlighted on the news, and it ends up showing that the competitor actually gave him the victory and allowed him to win and set it up so that Nate could feel better about himself. And so what this skit ironically was based around was a true story that took place about a high school wrestler who was undefeated, a multi-time state champion, and then allowed another competitor with a disability, who had an intellectual disability, allowed that wrestler to beat him. And so it was a lot of hype and buildup and great storyline that the wrestler with a disability beat the undefeated wrestler at the time. And not to discredit the action or the heart of the matter and what this did, perhaps for both parties and all other parties involved. However, I do want to call this into just a part of our conversation, because it brings forth the question of, is this a situation of full inclusion, or does it hint toward patronizing the athlete with a disability, or almost creating a mascot out of that athlete? And I want to give credit to Eli Wolf, who's a great advocate for disability rights within the sports setting, a former Paralympic athlete himself. And he brought this to light, sent an email out when it first came out on Saturday Night Live, and simply asked that question: does this do great things for the disability movement, or does it hold it back? And so we had a good conversation about that and sort of settled in on there was not malicious intent with this, but it does hold back the movement. And here's why. It's not necessarily full inclusion. We see these moments within our sport world where the athlete with autism is put in at the end of the game, or an athlete is allowed to score a touchdown. An athlete is praised for what he or she is doing and what they are doing during a normally scheduled activity. For them, it was just sport. Now, this can be uplifting. It can be, quote, inspirational. There's a variety of ways it can be treated. But I want to start with that anecdote just to sort of position our conversation as we move forward. And I also want to share this cartoon that really drives home the fact of what inclusion could be, or what infusion, I'm going to steal that term from some colleagues of mine as well, this idea of infusion. When we infuse something, we're not just including it one time, but we're making it a part of the fabric of what we do every day. And the cartoon shows some kids at the bottom of the stairs of a school, and there's snow preventing anyone from getting into the school. And right now, a custodial worker is shoveling the snow off the stairs, but not the ramp. So one of the kids at the bottom of the entranceway who uses a wheelchair says, "Hey, could you please shovel the ramp?" The custodial worker responds with, "Well, all these other kids are waiting to use the stairs. When I get through with the stairs, I'll clear off the ramp for you." And then, of course, the child responds with, "Well, if you shovel the ramp, then we can all get in." I think this really embodies what where our society sort of misses a little bit on what inclusion is. That if, you know, how many times are we focused too often on shoveling that ramp and allowing the majority to get in, and yet still excluding some members of the minority, when if we had just spent our energy and our time shoveling the ramp, all people could have gotten in, regardless of what minority group that they identify with. So that sort of situates our tone when it comes to inclusion and what that looks like. We're not going to watch this video here about Judith Heumann and disability rights, but I would point you to this perhaps outside of class or outside of your learning environment. Drunk History, which is a series within Comedy Central, provides sort of a comical take on some accurate history portrayals, but they provide a really nice piece on the history of disability rights and the fight for equality among the disability community. And Judith Heumann was really behind that, from things like chaining themselves to buses, public bus system within San Francisco area, to also using opportunities to climb the steps of the White House, getting out of the chair so that they use and climbing the steps of the courthouse buildings, climbing the steps of the Capitol building, and staging a protest inside the rotunda of the Capitol building. I would urge you and point you toward this for a little bit of a lighthearted look at a serious matter when it comes to disability rights. So I'm using all three of these to sort of set a foundation for us when we come into the idea of what the Americans with Disabilities Act, which is the current piece of legislation, and what it guarantees and prohibits. And I'll focus on one specific area here that it guarantees people with disabilities have the same opportunities as everyone else. We're not talking about giving preferential treatment. We're not talking about allowing someone to gain access before others necessarily. The Americans with Disabilities Act is simply there to guarantee equal opportunities. And I think that's one thing that's lacking within our sport world is equal opportunity. And I'll couch that under the idea of equal opportunity for competition as well. Because too often when we're talking about competition, these stories end up being feel-good stories. They end up being situations where perhaps they make us feel good as a society. Perhaps they make the person with a disability feel good because they were included. But again, I would go back to the idea of infusion. And are we including them and infusing them into the fabric of what we do as a society, and particularly as a society who is focused so heavily on sport? I'll do a little self-promotion here. This is a picture of me snow skiing. I have a disability. I have cerebral palsy. And this is me snow skiing in West Virginia with my instructor, Chris. And we have a good time over in West Virginia going down the mountains. Nothing like West Coast skiing, but it's still a good time. But I would also point out that the reason I'm bringing this up is there are alternative sports, which is a trend now as far as the growing interest of sport and sport participation. But these alternative sports provide a pretty good entrance way to full inclusion, whether it's snow skiing, water skiing, hand cycling, just basic exercise and fitness. We see campus recreation programs across the country that are really struggling to incorporate students with disabilities into their programming. And something like exercise classes and fitness spaces within their facility, those are easy ways to gain entrance and gain movement toward full inclusion or infusion by simply offering a different type of class, a class with low lighting, a class with lower noise, basically just communicating expectations upfront on the website. Those are elements of inclusion and infusion that can be done at low cost, if any cost at all, rather than going the most expensive route and purchasing heavy equipment or highly priced equipment such as sport wheelchairs to play wheelchair basketball. Now what we get into is when we look at disability, there are multitude of models that really describe disability and how it's portrayed, but we're going to look at two models that are sort of polar opposites. The first one is the medical model, which is a little bit outdated from the disability perspective. It views disability, if we're looking through that medical model lens, well, that means we're viewing disability as a problem for the individual. If I have a disability, it's my problem. Disability is viewed as something that can be corrected or cured or rehabilitated. It's different because it's not normal. And oftentimes our society falls into that trap simply because we're not exposed to it enough. And we're definitely not exposed to it enough in the sport world. How many times do we see disability sport focused or the central focus on SportsCenter, ESPN, or focused on any of our local sports feeds, or perhaps even in our daily reminders and our daily notifications through our apps on our phones? It's very rare, even in a Paralympic year, it's very rare that we see that coverage. One term I'll focus in on the bottom of that red square is handicapped, disabled, and crippled. Those are terms that are often used under the medical model and their outdated terms, just as other terms within the race and even the gender conversation are definitely outdated terms. Handicapped is an outdated term, and yet we still see it on signage across our country and across the, throughout the world. When we label people before we identify the person, that becomes a problem, and that is certainly an example under the medical model. What also is a prevalent example under the medical model is this idea and concept of an inspiration. Oftentimes, I'll be exercising in the gym, and someone comes up to me and says, "Oh my gosh, I just want to let you know you're such an inspiration." I didn't intend to be an inspiration. I'm just there trying to stay fit and active. So what that does is it results in this term that's a scholarly term among the researchers in disability called supercrip, where it's almost a superhuman quality that the general public is seeing there. Because we don't see people with disabilities so active and so involved in sport, when we do, it becomes so far beyond the norm of what our society typically sees that we identify and view it as superhuman. So example is, she competed despite suffering from disability. Well, disability didn't prevent her from competing. It's just that our understanding of it perhaps created a shock value. And that's where we need to work harder in society to create this idea of infusion, where it's just normal part of our everyday life. The polar opposite of that is the social model. And I've defined sport here according to Gubin from 1978, because I want us to keep in mind, we're talking about how this is incorporated into the sport world. Under the social model, disability is created simply by a lack of society's adjustment. Perhaps there's not a door, the door entrance is not proper. Perhaps the gym is upstairs, but no elevator. Perhaps there is not enough space in the physical activity space of the campus recreation facility. But under the social model says that that's not the individual's fault. That's our society's fault, because we're too far behind and haven't caught up yet to what the needs and the preferences are of all people. Under this model, disability is simply a quality. Race is a quality. Gender is a quality of an individual. Eye color can be a quality. Hair color, or perhaps no hair, can be a quality of an individual, just as disability is a quality. That means the person is much more important than that quality or than that feature. And that's where we fall into this concept of person-first language. And so there are many sources out there that provide the do's and the don'ts of person-first language. And this is not a universally accepted form of communication. In other parts of Europe and throughout the world, don't necessarily adhere to this. Throughout North America, this is typically the preferred method of speaking. And that's where we avoid defining the individual by the label first. I'll throw a few examples out here from this chart that are really overused. When we hear the term wheelchair bound or wheelchair confined, and what comes to mind is someone who is almost duct taped like a hostage to their wheelchair, when in fact it's the wheelchair that allows for mobility and allows for freedom. I use forearm crutches with my disability to walk around, and those are not limitations for me because of what's going on in my life. They actually allow me to move and allow me to get where I need to be. I think we see a variety of other things here, but I'll point once again to this concept of we're not encouraged to say disabled person under this model. We're encouraged to say person with a disability, because under this model, the person is more important than any label that we can put on there. Okay, and so I'm going to click through these fairly quickly of the inclusion spectrum. I'll give credit to Missner and Darcy from several years ago, who wrote an introduction to a special issue in a journal that was published. And in that introduction, they suggested this idea of the inclusion spectrum, that because our society really struggles with how to include people with disabilities in the sports setting, the inclusion spectrum gives us an idea of how to identify all of those different ways of inclusion. Fully integrated is when everyone participates without any adaptation. So we may play ping pong together and we're gonna participate in the same way. Modified integrated, that's a little bit more where there's a focus on a modification to the rule or the equipment. If we play golf, perhaps I use a golf cart, but you're not allowed to use a golf cart if we're in competition. Allowing that would be a modified integrated approach. Parallel activities is when we're participating in the same activity, but I'm going to participate in my own way. Maybe we both sign up for a 5K road race or a half marathon, but I'm going to use my hand cycle to participate and you're going to run. We're still competing in that 5K or the half marathon or perhaps both, yet I'm doing it my own way and you're doing it in your own way. That's a parallel activity. Adapted activities, when we see the participation was actually designed for people with disabilities, but people with and without disabilities can participate. Wheelchair basketball is a great example of this. Any of us can get into, any of us who are have the ability to get into a wheelchair and play wheelchair basketball, then we would be participating in adapted activities. Of course, not everyone is able to do that, but if we are able to, that's an adapted activity. And then finally, discrete activities, and that's when it's sort of like the Olympic or Paralympic model where we have different classifications so that we could put similarly, people with similar abilities matched up with each other, and that's really to preserve that competitive element. So I think the takeaway here is not all stories that focus and match disability with sport are just feel-good stories. A lot of these stories are about true competition. They're not an inspirational, they don't necessarily have an inspirational outlook or an inspirational focus on them. Sometimes it's just good to identify a feat, or an accomplishment, a sport situation, or perhaps even a failure, just for what it is within the sport setting. If we preserve the sport in disability sport and put less focus and emphasis on disability, that's when I think we'll end up being in the proper area of infusion where it becomes part of the fabric of what we're doing in the sport world. So I want to thank you for your time today. I want to stop sharing my screen there. I did provide my email address and I'm happy to talk more about this or communicate about it if you have questions. And I can point you in the direction where I got many of these resources on my side. So once again, my name is Josh Pate and I'm a faculty member at James Madison University in the Hart School on the sport and recreation management side. And I thank you so much for your time.